Mickey Mouse, Donald Duck, Minnie Mouse, and Goofy, four important and loved Disney animated characters. But what if I added Oswald the Lucky Rabbit to that list? Now, Oswald might not be a household name, but in another life, he might have been one of the world's most popular and famous cartoon characters. Oswald was Walt Disney's first big animated star, predating Mickey Mouse. And though he might not be well known, he is still very important to the history of animation. So with that, welcome everyone to the history of animation, Oswald the Lucky Rabbit. In 1921, Walt started his own film studio called Laugh-O-Gram in Kansas City, Missouri. The studio did well at first, creating several short animated cartoons called Newman's Laugh-O-Grams and employing several future pioneers of animation, such as Hugh Harman, Fritz Furling, and Up Iwerks, one of Walt's oldest friends and business associates. Sadly, after some bad business deals, the studio was tanking, but Disney, never being one to give up, used $500 from one of the studio's final projects to fund a live-action and animation hybrid film called Alice's Wonderland, which starred a young girl named Virginia Davis who would go on adventures in a cartoon world. Walt hoped that the film would be popular and would help save the studio. Things didn't work out that way, and in 1923, after finishing Alice's Wonderland, the studio filed for bankruptcy. After the studio closed, Walt worked as a freelance photographer and sold his camera to buy a one-way ticket to Los Angeles, California. There, he sent out proposals for the Alice series, hoping someone would pick it up. Eventually, the series was picked up by Winkler Productions, which was run by Margaret Winkler and her fiancé, Charles Mintz. The Alice comedies did really well, and by its end, 57 films were made in total, including the original film, Alice's Wonderland. In 1927, the Alice series was losing its popularity, and Walt was also feeling constrained by the limitation and costs of making the Alice comedies. So Walt and his good friend and chief animator, Up Iwerks, who Walt convinced to quit his job and move out to California, decided to end the series and work on new creative projects. As it just so happened, as they were canceling the Alice series, Universal Pictures was looking to get back into the animated business. Charles Mintz, Walt's distributor, who took over Winkler Productions after Margaret gave birth to their first child, was in talks with Universal to create a new animated property for them. So Mintz went to Walt and Ub and asked them to create a new character so they could sell it to Universal. This being the creative opportunity Walt was looking for, he agreed and got to work with Ub to create a new animated character. The only stipulation was that they didn't want it to be a cat, as at the time there were too many cat cartoon characters. In the end, they decided to go with a rabbit, and Walt and Ub sketched out some designs and sent them to Universal. The studio loved the designs and signed an agreement with Mintz for 26 animated shorts starring the new character. Now all that was left was to name the character. I would like to say that there was an interesting story in how they chose the name, but really, the studio had the right to name the character, and they decided just to pull a random name out of a hat. That name, of course, turned out to be Oswald, and now with a name and design, Walt and his small animation team set forth to create the first Oswald cartoon, called Poor Papa. They completed it in about 2 weeks, and it was rejected by Universal. Actually, no one was happy with the short. Walt and his team had rushed it out, so it didn't have the best production quality, which is what Universal and Mintz also thought. Universal and Mintz also thought that Oswald just didn't stand out in that cartoon, and he looked too old and sloppy. They wanted him to be young and snappy, with a monocle. Walt agreed with their notes, well, except the monocle thing. So when Walt and Ub made Oswald's second cartoon, Trolley Troubles, they made Oswald younger, streamlining his design so he wasn't so sloppy. The biggest change in Oswald, however, was in his personality. Walt set out to give him his own unique personality, to really make him stand out from other cartoon characters. Most cartoon series at that time focused on gags, and not really the cartoon character's personality. So by giving him his own unique personality, they hoped that he would stand out from those other characters. Which worked out, as his improved personality is what really made him popular. Trolley Troubles was also completed in 2 weeks, but the quality was much better. It was released on September 5th, 1927, and was the first Oswald cartoon released in theaters. With their focus on character and quality, the short was a big hit. People loved Oswald, and he was an instant success. It came to rival other big cartoon stars of the time, like Felix the Cat. In fact, Oswald was such a big hit, he even had his own merchandise, such as chocolate bars, stickers, and pinback buttons. And with the success of the Oswald series, this allowed the Walt Disney Studio to grow much larger and all but guarantee their future in the industry. Now, almost a year later, Walt and his studio were almost done working on the 26 cartoons they were hired to make, and with Oswald being such a big success, Walt was really sure that he could ask for more money when renewing his contract. Things didn't go as Walt had planned though, and in 1928, he was informed by UB that Mintz was going behind his back and signing away all of his animators. Walt couldn't believe it at first, but when UB, who had been a great and loyal friend to Walt for a very long time, told him he was also asked to sign a contract with Mintz, but refused out of loyalty, Walt knew it had to be true. You see, even though Oswald was a success, Mintz was not a fan of Walt, and he would take any chance he could to put him down and lecture him. Worse, he thought Walt didn't bring anything to the Oswald shorts since he was no longer an animator, and gave credit to Oswald's success to his brother-in-law, George Winkler, who Mintz had sent to the studio to supervise Walt. So when the Oswald contract was up for renewal with Universal, Mintz came up with this idea to open up his own animation studio and have George run it and produce the new Oswald cartoons without Walt. He was also able to easily sign away almost all of Walt's animators because at the time, Walt had become abusive to the staff and would often mistreat and insult them. Now, to be fair, pressure to produce great Oswald shorts with a low budget and Mintz constantly berating him was probably the cause of his bad behavior. But nonetheless, the staff was not happy and were more than willing to jump ship. In February of 1928, Mintz signed a new 3-year deal with Universal to produce the new Oswald shorts. And in the spring of the same year, Walt traveled to New York City in hopes that he could negotiate a more profitable contract with Mintz. In New York City, Walt went to other studios to shop around Oswald, hoping to get a competitive offer, which he wanted to use as leverage when negotiating with Mintz. Unfortunately, all the other studios turned him down. Now, with no leverage, he met with Mintz to negotiate, and the first meeting did not go well. Mintz said that he would not increase the amount of money per episode like Walt wanted, but he in fact wanted to slash the price by at least 20% and told Walt that he was pretty much a subcontractor and therefore disposable. Walt was not happy to say the least and was really starting to worry, so he wired his brother and business partner Roy Disney back in Los Angeles, telling him to prepare long-term contracts for his animators so he would not lose them. In their next meeting, Mintz refused to talk business, and Walt knew something was up, and he telegraphed his brother to get the animators to sign right away. Sadly, Roy informed Walt that it was too late. Most of the animators had already signed with Mintz. Things did not look good, but Walt did not give up, and he went to Universal, hoping to make a deal with them directly and cut out Mintz altogether. This would have worked, but Walt was informed that he didn't own Oswald, that Universal owned the character, and they had already signed a contract with Mintz, which gave him control over Oswald and Disney's zero rights to him. There was nothing Walt could do, and his greatest creation to that point was lost to him. Defeated, Walt got on a train back to Los Angeles. However, Walt was never one to give up, and as legend goes, on the train ride back, he came up with his greatest idea, Mickey Mouse, and of course, went on to big success. There's actually more to that, but that's a story for another time. Now, as for Oswald, Nitz took over the production of the series with his new Winkler studio and all the animators he stole from Disney. The Oswald series continued to be a success in their midst, and he even produced the first Oswald cartoon with sound in 1929 called Henfruit. Everything was going great for Mintz, but the world has an ironic sense of justice, as many of Mintz's animators started going behind his back to Universal. They wanted to remove him from the Oswald shorts and have one of the animators take over, as they were really unhappy with Mintz. Universal was also unhappy with him, so they cancelled his contract and moved production of the shorts to the Universal lot. So, just like Mintz took Oswald from Walt, Universal took Oswald from Mintz. None of the animators that wanted Mintz gone were assigned to produce the new Oswald series. Instead, Universal selected Walter Lantz, creator of Woody Woodpecker, who Mintz had hired to direct his Oswald cartoons after he took him from Walt. Interesting story. Walter was allowed to produce the Oswald cartoons because one night, he was out with Universal President Carl Lamel, and he bet him if he could beat him in a game of poker, then Oswald would be his to produce. And wouldn't you know it, he won. Now, supposedly before taking over production, Walter Lantz consulted with Walt and got his blessing to continue the Oswald series. At this point, Walt didn't mind too much because the Mickey Mouse cartoons had become more popular and successful than Oswald. Under Walter, Oswald saw several redesigns. First, small changes like giving him big white gloves, shoes, and a shirt. But in the 1935 cartoon, Case of the Lost Sheep, Oswald received his biggest redesign, becoming more realistic looking with white fur. The design was actually taken from one of Walter's other cartoons called The Fox and the Rabbit. Another notable difference during the Walter years was that Oswald gained a voice. He previously did not speak, but his first speaking cartoon was Cold Turkey in 1929, voiced by the animator Bill Nolan. And as time went by, he went on to have several voice actors, such as Mickey Rooney and June Foray. In 1935, Oswald got his first sound and color cartoon with Toyland Premiere, one of the few colored Oswald cartoons, as the majority of them are in black and white. However, his first color appearance was in a cameo in the live-action 1930 movie, The King of Jazz. By the end of the 1930s, Oswald was no longer as popular as he once was, and his series was slowly coming to an end. He had one last black and white cartoon in 1938 called Happy Scouts, and 5 years later, he got his last solo color cartoon called The Eggcracker Suite. His final appearances in the Universal cartoons were two cameos in Woody Woodpecker cartoons. Over a period of a decade, Walter produced 142 Oswald cartoons until the series was finally canceled. The total run of the Oswald series was 194 episodes, 27 cartoons produced by Walt Disney. His original contract was for 26 shorts, but since Poor Papa was not well received, it was accounted as one of the 26, 25 produced by Charles Mintz, and of course, the last 142 by Walter Lantz. His last animated appearance in a Universal cartoon was in 1951 in the Woody Woodpecker Polka. And while his animation career was seemingly over at this point, Oswald was not completely gone. Through the years, he had received several comic books. The first was made by DC Comics in 1935. His second series was by Dell Comics, which went on through the 60s. But after that, Oswald was gone and seemingly forgotten. Some people still did remember him, but he was gone from the public's eyes, and it kind of seemed like he was doomed to be forgotten in history and never seen again. Well, that's how his story originally ended, but like his name implies, Oswald is one lucky rabbit. In February of 2006, about 80 years after Walt was Oswald, and about 56 years since his last animated appearance, Disney CEO Bob Iger made an historic deal with NBC Universal. Disney released sportscaster Al Michaels from his ESPN employment contract so he can go and work with NBC Sports, and Disney got the rights back to Oswald the Lucky Rabbit and the original 27 Oswald cartoons made by Walt. You see, sometime in the 2000s, Walt Disney's daughter, Diane Disney Miller, told Bob Iger that she wanted Oswald to return home to Disney since she thought he was an important part of the Disney company's heritage and her father's legacy. Bob Iger agreed and told her that he also wanted to bring Oswald home. So when the opportunity presented itself, he took it. And after the deal was made, Walt Disney's daughter issued a statement saying, "When Bob Iger was named CEO, he told me he wanted to bring Oswald back to Disney. And I appreciate that he is a man of his word. Having Oswald around is going to be a lot of fun." Finally, after so long, Walt Disney's first big animated creation was back home, and Disney wasted no time cranking out the merchandise, such as t-shirts, plushes, and a DVD collection set of the original Oswald shorts. Well, the ones that had not been lost over time. Sadly, 7 of the 27 original shorts have been lost over time and are now considered lost media. And the majority of the Mint-produced ones are also lost. And several of the Walter-produced cartoons can also be considered lost media. Luckily, some of the shorts that were thought to be lost have been discovered in the recent years, but several still remain to be found. So, if you happen to have a stack of old cartoon films somewhere, you might want to check and see if you have one of the missing shorts. And now that Oswald was back home with Disney, in 2010, Oswald finally appeared alongside Mickey Mouse for the first time ever in the Wii-exclusive video game, Epic Mickey. The story of the game kind of mimics Oswald's real-life story. The story takes place in the Wasteland, the world of forgotten characters. Oswald being the first forgotten Disney character, dislikes Mickey for stealing the popularity he thinks would have been his if he had not been forgotten. It was an okay game, not perfect, but enjoyable enough, and a good welcome back for Oswald. The game also did good enough to get a sequel in 2012, Epic Mickey 2, The Power of Two. In this game, Oswald and Mickey team up for an adventure. In my opinion, it's not very good. A third and final Epic Mickey game was planned, but due to the low sales of the second game, it was cancelled. In 2012, completion of the expansion of California Adventure was completed, and one of the new things added was Oswald's Service Station, a gift shop that sells only Oswald merchandise. I love that store. Then, a couple of years later in 2014, an Oswald costume cartoon character started showing up next to the filling station for meet and greets. After that, not much else was done with Oswald. He had a couple of Easter eggs in Big Hero 6 and Zootopia, and a couple of cameos in the short Get a Horse and the new Mickey Mouse cartoons. But that's it. He hasn't had any big roles in any animated projects or anything else. It seemed like Disney was starting to forget him. Well, it would seem that way. But at the D23 2017 Expo, Bob Iger spoke about how one of his biggest accomplishments in the company was getting Oswald back. And he is aware that they haven't done much with him, but that they do have plans for him in the future.
But it's actually one of my proudest moments. This was a great way to honor our founder, Walt Disney. And I think he'd be thrilled to know that Oswald is back home. Now, frankly, We have not done enough with Oswald yet, but we're working on it, and we've come up with a few very interesting ideas. Maybe. We have any others? No, I don't think so. No? Okay. Well, anyway, you get the story. I think we have a lot of work to do, but don't worry, Oswald's got a great future ahead of him.
It kind of came off as a comedic moment, but it's good to see that Disney has not forgotten Oswald. And I do believe Bob Iger when he says that they do have plans for Oswald. So here we are, 90 years since Oswald was created. He might not be a big superstar that he could have been, but his importance to Disney and the history of animation cannot be denied. Especially when it comes to Walt Disney, since Oswald taught him many important lessons, like the importance of characters with personality, merchandising those characters, and the biggest lesson of them all, that he should always own the rights to his creations so no one can take them away from him. And while many questions still plague the character, like had Disney kept the rights to Oswald, would he have been a big hit like Mickey? Would Disney have become a mega company like it is today? And what's next for Oswald? One thing is for sure, that while many cartoon characters of that era have faded away, this colorful rabbit, created by Walt and Ubbs so long ago, continues to be appealing. Thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video. And if you want to learn more about Oswald the Lucky Rabbit, I recommend this book by David Bossart, Oswald the Lucky Rabbit, The Search for the Lost Disney Cartoons, as well as this Disney's Treasure DVD collecting most of the original Oswald Disney shorts. Like I said before, most of the original Disney shorts have been lost, but this book does a good job of covering most of them, and this DVD collection has most of the original cartoons. They have found more since then, but it doesn't include it, but it's a good collection nonetheless. As always, thanks for watching, like and subscribe if you did enjoy this video, and comment down below. Let me know if you want to see more of these videos or what cartoon characters interest you. Okay, catch you later.